Welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel Network Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Dennis Murray. Wisdom is understanding God's Word. Pastor Murray's unique teaching approach brings God's Word alive with meaning as he takes you on a chapter-by-chapter, verse-by-verse study of God's letter to you, the Bible. And now, here is Pastor Dennis Murray.
Good day to you. God bless you. Welcome to Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this Family Bible Study Hour. Ready to get back into our Father's Word here at the chapel? We invite you to get your Bible and join us if you care to. We're going to pick it up today, 2 Kings chapter 3, verse 1. And we come to the reign of Jehoram, who was the son of Ahab. You see, you had another son of Ahab that was king over the 10 northern tribes, Israel, Ahaziah, for 2 years, but he died, and having no son, Jehoram received the reign over the 10 northern tribes. So in our last lecture, of course, we saw Elijah taken up in that whirlwind, and before he went, he asked Elisha, you know, ask what you will of me. And Elisha said, I want a double portion of the Spirit of the Lord that's on you, which was a very difficult thing to ask of Elijah to do. Elijah said, if you see me, and in other words, it was the Lord's to give or not to give, but he said, if the Lord allows you to see into that dimension and you can see the whirlwind taking me up to heaven and the transfiguration, then you will have received God's blessing and the double portion. So, and I'll remind you too, what is the reward for God's elect? If those who overcome and don't worship the Antichrist, they receive a double portion as well. There's one other that receives a double portion in the book of Revelation. That's Sister Babylon, that's confusion. I don't think I want any part of her reward though. With that, let's ask that word of wisdom in Yeshua's precious name. Father, we ask you to open eyes, open ears this day as we pick it up, 2 Kings chapter 3, verse 1, and it reads, now Jehoram means Yah has exalted, and the Lord doesn't exalt Jehoram. He does a real good job of exalting himself, though. The son of Ahab began to reign over Israel in Samaria, the 18th year of Jehoshaphat. Jehoshaphat was king of Judah for 25 years, so Jehoshaphat has 7 years to go, and the king of Judah and reigned 12 years. Now, you remember, too, that the prophet of the Lord prophesied that the seed, the descendants, the children of Ahab, would be extinguished, exterminated, if you will. So Jehoram is the last descendant of Ahab to take the throne. Again, the reason he was there, because Ahaziah, the older brother of Jehoram, did not have any children when he passed away. Verse 2, and he wrought, this is Jehoram, wrought evil in the sight of the Lord, but not like his father, that's Ahab, and like his mother, Jezebel. Ahab, his father, dead at this point in time. I think Jezebel probably still alive at this point in time. For he put away the image of Baal that his father had made. He pulled the image of Baal, but he wasn't perfect in the eyes of the Lord. He wasn't as bad as his mother and Jezebel and his father Ahab. That's not saying much. Verse 3. Nevertheless, he cleaved unto the sins of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, which made Israel to sin. He departed not therefrom. And of course, the sins of Jeroboam were the fact that he created the two golden calves and told the people, you don't need to go all the way down to Jerusalem to worship the Lord. Here are these two golden calves, one in Dan and one in Bethel. You can worship them. These are the gods that brought your parents out of bondage in Egypt. God doesn't like people worshiping other gods and worshiping molten images. Verse 4. And Mesha, king of Moab, was a sheep master and rendered unto the king of Israel 100,000 lambs and 100,000 rams with the wool. This latter phrase, I think, means that he gave them 100,000 lambs and the wool from 100,000 rams. And this, no doubt, was done on a yearly basis as tribute. Then when Ahab passed away, what we're going to find out is that the king of Moab, Mesha, is going to want to quit giving this tribute. He senses that the leadership of the nation is diminished or weakened when Ahab died, so he thinks he can stop giving the tribute to Israel. In Appendix 54, if you have a companion Bible, Mesha, you'll learn, is one of the names that was found on a historic artifact known as the Moabite Stone. Verse 5. It came to pass when Ahab was dead that the king of Moab rebelled against the king of Israel. He didn't want to continue paying tribute to Ahaziah and nor to Jehoram, who came after Ahaziah. Verse 6. And King Jehoram went out of Samaria the same time, that's the capital of the 10 northern tribes, and numbered all Israel. He mustering the troops. He's not going to allow Mesha to stop his annual tribute without a fight. Now, we learn in 2 Chronicles chapter 20 that Moab, Ammon, and it's called Seir, which is the same as Edom, were attacking Judah at this time as well, and might explain what happens next. Verse 7. And he went and sent to Jehoshaphat, the king of Judah, saying, The king of Moab hath rebelled against me. Wilt thou go with me against Moab to battle? And he said, I will go up. I am as thou art, my people as thy people, and my horses as thy horses. Does that sound familiar from our study in 1 Kings? No, it should. That's the same words, basically, that Jehoshaphat said to Jehoram's father, Ahab, when he asked him to go up with him against Ben-Hadad, the king of Syria, at Ramoth-Gilead. It almost cost Jehoshaphat his life, you may recall. You know, it looks like Jehoshaphat would learn, and again, we see problems arising for Jehoshaphat because of the relationship that he had developed with the house of Ahab. Jehoshaphat also had a son named Jehoram who married the daughter of Ahab and Jezebel. Her name was Athaliah, and it continued to be a thorn in Judah and Jehoshaphat's side for many, many years. But in Jehoshaphat's, you know, it looks like Jehoshaphat would have learned from that experience at Ramoth-Gilead, being my point. But in Jehoshaphat's defense, I mentioned that in 2 Chronicles chapter 20, we had Moab, Ammon, and Edom, which is Seir, were fighting against Judah. So perhaps Jehoshaphat thought, well, you know, we can fight them here or we can fight them there, and it would be better probably for us to fight them with the 10 northern tribes. We'd have a better chance of defeating the Moabites. Verse 8, and he, this is Jehoram, king of Israel, said, which way shall we go up? And there were two ways that they could go up. We'll cover that in a minute. And he, Jehoshaphat, answered, the way through the wilderness of Edom, through the desert of Edom. And there were two ways that they could go. They could go north of the Dead Sea, crossing Jordan, and then heading south and attacking Moab from the north. or they could drop south of the Dead Sea, cross over, go through the desert of Edom, and then attack Moab from the south. They've chosen the latter. And you notice one thing, though, is anyone asking God whether they should go up against Moab and fight? I haven't heard anybody ask yet. Verse 9. So the king of Israel went, and the king of Judah, and the king of Edom. Now, back in a previous chapter, we learned that the royal seed line of Edom, there wasn't a king sitting on the throne, that it was a deputy king. In fact, that was in chapter 22, verse 47, the last chapter of 1 Kings, that we learned that there was a deputy king, or a vassal king, if you would. And they fetched a compass, which means they made a circle, of 7 days' journey. And there was no water for the host, for the army, and for the cattle that followed them. Now, this was some poor planning, or possibly the supply of water that they were planning on having available to them was dried up. And you know, you can get in trouble in a hurry in the desert when you have no water. And some might ask, well, why did they have their cattle following the military? Well, you see, at this time, there wasn't a hamburger joint on every corner. And if you wanted to not starve to death, you took your meat on the hoof with you and then slaughtered it as needed. Either that or you went hungry. They're not only going to be not hungry, they're going to be lacking for water, as we see in that verse 9, verse 10. And the king of Israel, this is Jehoram, said, alas, that the Lord hath called these three kings together, Edom, Judah, and Israel, to deliver them into the hand of Moab. Well, number one, God didn't gather them at all. They didn't even ask God. But we see here Jehoram has no confidence in the Lord, but not only that, he's blaming God for bringing us out here to die in this desert. Verse 11, but Jehoshaphat said, is there not here a prophet of the Lord that we may inquire of the Lord by him? And one of the king of Israel's servants answered and said, here is Elisha, the son of Shaphat, which poured water on the hands of Elijah. This last phrase means that he ministered or served Elijah. In other words, when Elijah washed his hands, Elisha was the one who poured the water over his hands. There was a similar situation in 1 Kings chapter 22, verse 7, where Jehoshaphat, I had mentioned, was going up with Ahab to fight against Ben-Hadad, the king of Syria. And Jehoshaphat asked the same thing after the 400 prophets of Ahab were prophesying, go up and you'll have the victory over Ben-Hadad. And Jehoshaphat at that time said, isn't there one real prophet of the Lord that we can inquire of? And that's when they called on Micaiah. I guess it's better to ask the Lord late than never. Verse 12. And Jehoshaphat said, the word of the Lord is with him, referring to Elisha. So the king of Israel and Jehoshaphat and the king of Edom went down to him. Now this is pretty humble for the three kings of Israel, Judah, and Edom to go down to Elisha. You see, they're desperate. Normally, kings would be in such a situation that they would demand that the party that they wanted to talk with come to them. Again, they're desperate and they go to Elisha. Things are looking bad and they're gonna have people start falling out because they don't have any water in the desert. Verse 13, and Elisha said unto the king of Israel, Jehoram, what have I to do with thee? Get thee to the prophets of thy father and to the prophets of thy mother. They always had some 400 prophets of Baal, or 400 prophets of the groves, 400 prophets of this and that. None of them were prophets of the Lord. And the king of Israel said unto him, Nay, or no, for the Lord hath called these three kings together to deliver them into the hand of Moab. And God again had not called them together. And again, we see Jehoram blaming God. And you know, that's something that you don't ever want to do, is blame God for the problems that you have brought upon yourself. God doesn't bring problems upon his children. If you think he does, you need to read Jeremiah chapter 23, where we learn there that you're not to say, the burden, what burden has the Lord put on me today? And God says it makes him very angry there. And if you do that, he'll forsake you, and he'll also cause whatever burden you accused him of putting on you, he'll make certain that it comes upon you anyway. It's your own mouth, verse 14. And Elisha said, As the Lord of hosts liveth, before whom I stand, or before I serve, surely, were it not that I regard the presence of Jehoshaphat, the king of Judah, I would not look toward thee nor see thee. I wouldn't give you the time of day, speaking to Jehoram, if it weren't that Jehoshaphat was here inquiring of the Lord as well. Jehoshaphat, just as his father Asa, were they perfect? No. Were they good kings? Were they righteous? Yes, they were, and not once did they fall away into idolatry. Verse 15, but now bring me a minstrel. This is a harper, a musician, in other words. This is Elisha speaking. And it came to pass, when the minstrel played, that the hand of the Lord came upon him. And there's some controversy over who is intended by the hymn here, whether it was the musician, and this would prove that God can use whoever he chooses, or was it Elisha? Verse 16. And he said, again, the he not clear here, it could have been Elisha or the harper, Thus saith the Lord, make this valley full of ditches. Make this valley from one end to the other, wall to wall trenches. Verse 17, For thus saith the Lord, ye shall not see wind, neither shall ye see rain, yet that valley shall be filled with water, that ye may drink both ye and your cattle and your beast. And it's a good thing that Jehoshaphat sent to inquire of the Lord, or went to inquire of the Lord through the prophet Elisha. Things were looking desperate. Verse 18, And this is but a light thing, this is but an easy thing, continues the prophecy. In the sight of the Lord he will deliver the Moabites also into your hand. It's an easy thing for the Lord to bring you water. It's also an easy thing for him to give you the victory over the Moabites. Verse 19, the prophecy continues. And you shall smite every fenced city. This is every walled city, the larger cities, in other words. And every choice city. And shall fell every good tree, every tree that produces fruit, olive trees included. You're going to cut them down. And stop all wells of water. Fill the wells up with rocks where people can't get a bucket down to fetch water. And mar, or spoil, the Hebrew word actually is grieve, every good piece of land with stones. In other words, not only are you to, this is kind of a ban that's been placed on Moab. Not only do I want you to kill all the Moabites, I want you to destroy their land as well. Verse 20, And it came to pass in the morning, when the meat offering was offered, or after the morning offering was offered, that behold, there came water by the way of Edom, and the country was filled with water. All those trenches that they had dug in the valley, in the wilderness, the desert of Edom, filled completely with water, life-saving water for the soldiers, their horses, and their cattle. And you know, any time that we talk about life-saving water, there is a water that you can partake of. It's called the living water, that water that will save your life. And I'm not talking about your flesh life. I'm talking about something much more important, your spiritual life. It gives eternal life. And of course, I'm talking about our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. 21. And when all the Moabites heard that the kings, this is of Israel, Judah, and Edom, were come up to fight against them, they gathered all that were able to put on armor, all that were old enough to put on armor, and upward or and older, and stood in the border. They're girded on their battle attire, and they're standing ready for battle. And they rose up early in the morning, and the sun shone upon the water. That's the water that was had filled the valley. And the Moabites saw the water on the other side as red as blood. Now, the scholars disagree on how this, what happened here, what this means that the water turned to blood. Some claim that since the sun was just coming up, that the sun reflecting off of the water simply made the water to look red. Some scholars say the soil in this area of the world, when it comes in contact with water, it turns the water red. Either way, what is happening here is the Moabites see it, and we're going to learn that what they thought had happened is that Israel and Judah had fought against each other, which would not be anything new, because that was a battle that carried on in animosities over the decades. Verse 23, and they said, this being the Moabites, this is blood. The kings are surely slain. They've killed each other, and they have smitten one another. Now therefore, Moab to the spoil. This is easy pickings. They've killed each other. Now we can go take their valuables and their weapons and for ourselves. Verse 24. And when they came to the camp of Israel, the Israelites rose up and smote the Moabites, so that they fled before them. But they went forward, smiting the Moabites even in their country. And this was quite common. Once you got the enemy on the run, there were probably as many of the enemy killed as you pursued as there were in the initial battle. Because when the enemy is running, you can come from behind them and take them down. They've got other business to take care of in Moab as well. There's prophecy that needs to be fulfilled. Instructions from God that needs to be followed. Will they follow God's instruction? And they beat down the cities, and on every good piece of land cast every man his stone and filled it. Here, so far they're obeying God's word. And they stopped all the wells of water and felled all the good trees, all the fruit trees and the olive trees. Only in Kir-Hareseth, the capital of Moab, left they the stones thereof, probably in the wall. Howbeit, or until, the slingers went about it and smote it. And these slingers, you will recall that what David took Goliath down with, it was his sling. And that was a weapon that was used in war. And that's what this is saying, that the stones were remained in the wall until the slingers took it, the rock out of it, and took it down. Verse 26. And when the king of Moab, this is Mesha, saw that the battle was too sore for him, that they were losing and losing badly, getting their gourds thumped, he took with him 700 men, no doubt hand-picked men, that drew swords to break through even unto the king of Edom, but they could not. And he presumed that the Edomites, probably the weaker of Judah, Israel, and Edom, and therefore he thought, well, we'll break through and make a run for it through Edom, but they weren't successful in that. What did he do after that? Verse 27, then he took his eldest son that should have reigned in his stead, the heir to the throne, and offered him for a burnt offering upon the wall, probably to Chemosh or to Molech. And he did this in the sight of Israel and Judah. Human sacrifice was done by some of the kings of Israel, but never of a king of Judah. And there was a great indignation. This means that there was a great wrath against Israel. And they departed from him and returned to their own land. They didn't follow through with what God had instructed them to do. Much like Ahab failed to accomplish the mission that God gave him. God instructed Ahab, you destroy Ben-Hadad and the Assyrians. I've given them to you, but you take care of it. Kill them. And what did Ahab do? Well, he said to Ben-Hadad, oh, my brother, come on up into my chariot with me. We're going to name a few streets in Samaria after your relatives, like you named a few streets in Damascus after my ancestors. But they didn't accomplish the mission that God put upon them. That's probably the reason that Moab would later take many of the cities of Israel, and in Reuben and Gad particularly. Chapter 20 of 1 Kings, Ahab and Ben-Hadad, we had much the same similar situation. Chapter 4, we come to miracles performed by Elisha, and we also see the history of Elisha and the Shunammite woman. Let's go with chapter 4, verse 1. Now there cried a certain woman of the wives of the sons of the prophets unto Elisha, saying, thy servant, my husband, is dead. She's a widow. Her husband was one of the sons of the prophets of the schools of Elijah and Elisha. And thou knowest that thy servant did fear the Lord. He was a good man. He revered the Lord. And the creditor is come to take unto him my two sons to be bondmen. In other words, when her husband died, he evidently had money that he owed to this one who came to collect, the creditor. And this is by the law, Leviticus chapter 25, verses 39 and 40. If you owed someone of Israel, they had the right to make you, and you could not pay, then they had the right to make you a servant. Now, you weren't to be treated, if you were of the house of Israel, as a slave, but as a servant, a hired servant. And then, of course, that was for a period of 7 years, no matter how much was owed. After 7 years, the party was to be released, either that or, of course, when the year of Jubilee came around, which rolled around every 50th year, all servants were to be set free. Verse 2, and Elisha said unto her, what shall I do for thee? Tell me, what hast thou in the house? What do we have to work with here? And she said, thine handmaid hath not anything in the house save a pot of oil. And of course, this would be olive oil. I want you to check out this word pot in Hebrew. It's asuk, and it means to smear. as anointing oil. You see, at this time, olive oil was a valuable commodity. You may recall when we first began the Kings that Solomon made contracts with Hiram, and part of the trade for the wood that they needed to build the house of God and other buildings and Solomon's building appetite, one of the things that they traded was olive oil. Verse 3, "And he said, Go borrow the vessels abroad of all thy neighbors, even empty vessels, borrow not a few." Go and get as many empty vessels as you can get. No doubt she sent her two sons to fetch as many empty vessels as they could get their hands on. Verse 4, "And when thou art come in, thou shalt shut the door upon thee and upon thy sons, and shalt pour out into all those vessels, and thou shalt set aside that which is full." Keep pouring. When one of the larger vessels is full, have one of your sons grab it and move it aside. The other one put an empty under, and the oil continued to flow from the small flask, this being the miracle. The reason that he wanted the door shut, he didn't want to create a circus sideshow, a spectacle, if you will. There was no purpose in anyone witnessing this particular miracle. Verse 5, "So she went from him and shut the door upon her and upon her sons, who brought the vessels to her, and she poured out," began to follow Elisha's instructions. And, you know, the oil, we learn in James chapter 5, verse 14, part of the meaning is to obey God. And there in James chapter 5, verse 14, God said, if any of you are sick or ill, you go to the elders and you anoint with the oil of our people. Oil, the olive oil in particular, also symbolic of truth. In Matthew chapter 25, you have the 10 virgins there. Some of them had enough oil, enough truth. Some of them didn't, to attend the wedding feast. And of course, the bridegroom was Jesus when he returns at the second advent. Verse 6, and we'll stop for the day. "And it came to pass, when the vessels were full, that she said unto her son, Bring me yet a vessel, bring another empty vessel. And he said unto her, There is not a vessel more, all the vessels are full. And the oil stayed," the oil stopped. Let's go one more verse, a better place to stop. "Then she came and told the man of God, and he said, Go sell the oil and pay thy debt, and live thou and thy children off the rest." Well, not only was there enough proceeds from the never-ending supply of oil out of this flask that she was able to pay off the creditor to where her sons did not have to become bondmen, there was enough for them to live off of as well. God always provides for his own, and we see the miracles. Elijah performed 8 miracles. Elisha performed double that, 16 miracles. We see more in our next lecture. We've got a short message. We'll ask you to listen a moment, won't you please?
The Mark of the Beast on CD is our free introductory offer to you. What is the Mark of the Beast? Many false teachers would have you believe it will be a tattoo on your forehead or a computer chip implanted under your skin. It's getting late in the game. You need to know what the Mark of the Beast is. As it's written in Revelation chapter 13, verse 8, many will be deceived. Christ said in Mark 13:23, "Behold, I have foretold you all things." Jesus indeed told us how not to be deceived, and Pastor Arnold Murray takes you on a step-by-step study of God's Word concerning this critical subject. The telephone call is free. The CD is free. No shipping and handling. Just call 800-643-4645 to request your one-time, one-per-household copy of The Mark of the Beast. You may also mail your request to Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. Don't be deceived by Satan.
Welcome back. We're glad you could join back with us. Let's have the 800 number, please. 800-643-4645. That number good throughout Puerto Rico, the U.S., and Canada. If you have a biblical question that you'd like to pose to be answered on the air, feel free to call that 800 number and leave your question. Please don't ask questions about a specific individual, denomination, or organization by name. We try to teach God's word in a positive format. Throwing out negative about others by name serves no purpose. We simply won't do it. If you're studying via the internet somewhere around the world and not able to use that 800 number, your announcer at the end of the hour will give you our mailing address. Quite all right to mail your questions in, being the point. Got a prayer request? Well, you can do away with the 800 number. You don't need a telephone. You don't need a mailing address. I encourage you to talk to your Heavenly Father. Make time each day to pray. That's how you communicate with your Heavenly Father, and He's the closest relative that you have. You should be able to talk to Him just like you would your flesh father. Let Him know that you love Him. If you do, you can't con God. Always remember, He knows your heart. He knows your mind. But we do have these prayer requests. Father, we come united as one in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. We ask you to look upon these, Father. We ask you to comfort those that are mourning, Father. We ask a touch of healing for those who are ill, Father. We lift up our military troops who are in harm's way around the world, Father. We ask you to watch over, guide, direct, touch, heal in Jesus' precious name. Amen. And thank you, Father. All right, let's get to some questions. And we got first up Michael in Texas. I have heard you say that tuna fish was a clean fish to eat because they have fins and scales. That's correct. Are you sure they have scales? I have been told that tuna fish do not have scales by someone who has caught tuna fish. He said that their skin is slick like catfish. I'm asking that you check into this a little further. Just trying to help. And he mentions Leviticus 11:12, which is where it states that from the waters, whatever you eat must have fins and scales to be clean. Well, Mike, I went down to our local creek here, Spavinaw Creek, where we baptize, and I caught me a tuna fish. And that, I'm kidding, obviously. There are no tuna fish in Arkansas. So I wasn't able to catch one, but I did double check, and I am quite certain that tuna have fins and scales, making tuna clean to eat, to consume. Gail in Alabama, my question, Numbers chapter 5, verses 16 through 22. I understand if she is caught with a man and she is married, but I do not understand, is the bitter water her thigh to rot and her belly to swell, etc.? And of course, that was only if she were unfaithful. It sounds like if she had a baby by another man and she is married to someone else but passed through the bow. Please explain your misunderstanding. That in Numbers chapter 5, what we're talking about is if a woman is suspected of being unfaithful to her husband, and that is when they took the water, which contains some of the dust from the floor, and it's listed there in Numbers chapter 5. But if, and when she drank the water, if she had been unfaithful, you're right, it caused her thigh to drop, which is thought to be some type of dropsy of the ovary, or ordinary dropsy, which is basically edema. And the point is that it affected the body organs that were utilized to commit the sin if the woman had been unfaithful to her husband. Now, of course, if she had not been unfaithful to her husband, the water would have no effect upon her whatsoever. Patricia in Oregon. No need to apologize. There's no silly or stupid question. In Matthew chapter 22, verse 30, Jesus says people won't marry or be given in marriage, that we will be like the angels. So I assume no one will get pregnant and give birth, as there won't be any male, female types, correct? We will all be God's children. And then you question Isaiah 65, 17 through 25, says we will have children and they will no longer die in infancy. Well, exactly what it says there in Isaiah, Patricia, is there shall be no more infants dying a few days old, nor an old man that hath not fulfilled his days. And what that is, doesn't mean that we're going to have children in the spiritual bodies. What it's saying is no longer will infants die a few days old, or an old man not reach old age. Age in a spiritual body is really irrelevant. It's not a factor. Why? Because in the spiritual bodies, our bodies do not age. Carolyn in Oregon, please can you tell me where to find God's name? And you write YHVH, which is Yahweh, in the Strong's Concordance. Is it spelled? And you make a stab at it. I'm embarrassed to not know. Well, don't be embarrassed. I'm never ashamed to say, when someone asks me a question, I'm never embarrassed to say, I don't know the answer to that, but let's find out together and we'll dig it out of God's Word. The word Lord in uppercase, L-O-R-D, 98%, 99% of the time in the Old Testament is from the Hebrew word in your Strong's Concordance, 3068, which is Yahweh. If you haven't done it, you might request, Carolyn, a free paper that we offer is done by Pastor Arnold Murray called The Sacred Name. If you're ordering or making a donation, simply request the Sacred Name paper. If you don't wish to order or make a donation, send a self-addressed stamped envelope and request the Sacred Name paper. It's free. Gail in Washington, I would like to thank you, to you and the many people that work behind the scene at the chapel, and thanks for remembering our staff. We have a very dedicated group of volunteers and employees. I understand the teaching, when the silver cord breaks, you are present with the Lord, but I'm confused about the following verse. John chapter 5, verse 28, marvel not at this, for the hour is coming in the which all that are in the grave shall hear his voice. Would you please explain the use of the word graves? I did not find an alternative use for the word other than tomb or memorial in Strong's Concordance. If we go to the Lord when the silver cord breaks, why would we be told we will hear his voice in the grave? And what this is talking about, and thanks for you, I appreciate to hear your explanation on the air. You're welcome in advance. After the crucifixion, Jesus went to those who had passed away on earth before the crucifixion. In other words, he went to, they're called prisoners in 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 18 and 19. You see, it wouldn't have been fair for God to judge those who died before the crucifixion, in other words, those who were under the law, with those who were living under grace after the crucifixion. So Jesus went to those who had passed away before the crucifixion, as it's written in 1 Peter chapter 3, 18 and 19, and as it's written in chapter 4, many believed. Sherry in Georgia, what were the 10 talents that God gave out? And Sherry is referring to Matthew chapter 25, verse 14, and the following verses. And that states that the kingdom of heaven is like a man traveling into a far country. And the analogy is that Jesus was here on earth, and he's traveling into a distant place. He's with the Lord. but he trusted his goods with his servants. In other words, while I'm gone, take what I have and make good with it. To one he gave 5 talents, to one he gave 2 talents, and to one he gave 1 talent. The first two took the 5 and made another 5, returned 10. The one who had 2 made another 2 and returned 4. The one who he gave 1 to took it and buried it in the sand, and when the master came back, he dug it up and said, "Here's your talent back." And the lesson is that to the first 2, the Lord said, "Well done, my good and faithful servant. You've been faithful with a little. I'm going to give you much to be over in the kingdom." The number 10 in biblical numerics is responsibility and judgment, and judgment's rewards. So we all get what we deserve on Judgment Day is the lesson. James from Louisiana, during Satan's 5-month reign on earth, will there be conceptions between his fallen angels and the daughters of men again? I know there won't be time for births. You're right there, that takes 9 months. That's very possible. In Matthew chapter 24, verse 37, Jesus says it's going to be just like in the days of Noe, N-O-E, which is the Greek transliteration of Noah in the Hebrew language. And what were they doing? They were giving and taking in marriage. So, yeah, conceptions happen when that happens. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, Paul warns us about the angels. And he's, of course, talking about the fallen angels. Michael, and we don't know where Michael's from, thanks to all and hello to the staff family. Do you think that Moses was perhaps a stutterer? Another thing, that he was always reminded of his position. Just a thought, thanks again. Well, in Exodus chapter 4, verse 10, when God was letting Moses know that he had been chosen to lead the nation of Israel out of Egypt, Moses was kind of reluctant. He said, "You know, Lord, I'm not an eloquent speaker. I'm slow of speech and slow of tongue." And check out that word "slow" in your Strong's Concordance. It's kabed, and it means heavy. It's possible that Moses was a stutterer, and of course after that, though, the Lord said, "No, you're not getting off the hook that easy. Here, Aaron, your brother, he's a smooth talker. He'll be the main preacher, high priest, but you're still in charge of leading Israel out of bondage and into the promised land." Robert in South Carolina, marriage. What is marriage? Is it a vow between God, woman, and man? Where does the state come into marriage? Well, the state should be involved in a marriage when there's a possibility of children being conceived and born. In the event that the marriage does not work out, a civil license protects the rights of the children. You continue. Also, in God's word, you know, a man, when he spread his skirt, that means when he had intercourse with a woman, they were married. There's no vow that's to be repeated from God's word concerning a marriage. You continue with the second question. The language of tongues, I can't read your writing. Does one speak and one interpret, or one speak and the other interpret? Well, tongues means languages. And if you understand a language that's being spoken, there's no need for an interpreter. And that was the evidence of the Holy Spirit of Acts chapter 2, verse 4, and the following verses, was that there were people there from all over the world that spoke many different languages. And when the disciples spoke that cloven tongue, It was the evidence of the Holy Spirit, because the people, all the people understood, and that's the same language that God's elect will speak when they're delivered up before the synagogue of Satan. Nate in Virginia, I'm writing to ask a question about the unpardonable sin. I've watched the chapel for about 5 years now. I had great respect for your father, Arnold. I myself am a former Marine, and Marines are a brotherhood all of their own, and you're right there, and thanks for serving our country, Nate. But according to your father and you, the unforgivable sin is refusing to allow the Holy Spirit to speak through you. Well, I read in the book of Mark, chapter 3, verse 30, says the scribes said Jesus cast out devils by Beelzebub, the prince of devils. In verse 29, Jesus said, he that blasphemed the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit, let's say, hath never forgiveness. The scribes said that they, and I can't read your writing, in verse 22, Jesus said what he said in verse 29 and verse 30, says, because they, meaning the scribes, said, because he hath an unclean spirit. You're misunderstanding Mark chapter 3. The he in verse 30 is Jesus, not the one who had the unclean spirit that Jesus started out was going to cast it out by Beelzebub. Jesus taught a very important lesson there, and that was the devil can't cast out himself. And that's what they were accusing Jesus of, casting out demons in the name of Beelzebub. In other words, a house divided falls. But in verse 30, the he is Jesus. You see, the scribes were saying Jesus has an unclean spirit in him, and the only spirit that Jesus had in him was the Holy Spirit. As far as the unforgivable sin, Nate, Luke chapter 12, start with verse 10 and the following verses, and hopefully that will come. There's a work by Pastor Arnold Murray as well, CD format or cassette tape, you might consider ordering if you're confused on that subject. It's called The Unforgivable Sin, or The Unpardonable Sin, one of the two. Linda from Florida, what does it mean, where two or more are gathered in my name, there I am also? Does that mean if I'm alone, he's not here? No, you're misunderstanding, dear. Matthew chapter 18, verse 20 is talking about what constitutes a church. And Jesus is teaching there, wherever two, you don't have to have a big fancy cathedral that thousands of people come every Sunday to. Wherever two or three or more are gathered in my name, there I am in the midst of them also, is what Jesus is saying there. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5, the Lord says there, I will never leave you, I will never forsake you. If you love and serve him, you can take that to the bank. Clyde in North Carolina, don't you think the half hour represents a period or a length of time? Everything in Revelation is speaking of the word hour represents a length of time. The half hour could represent the 5 month period. No, I think the 5 month period is the hour of temptation, and half of that, and it states in Revelation there was silence in heaven for half an hour. I think the reason there's silence in heaven for half an hour is because half of that 5 month period, Satan's not in heaven. Where is he? He's here on earth. And as it states in Revelation chapter 12, woe unto you on earth. H.R. in Iowa, in Genesis 1 through 6, where does the name Adam, I know that there was a man to tend to the animals that God put forth, but there was not a name. In the eighth day creation, you say that at Haddam, you read it's Eth Ha'adam. I hope that it is the right name. I cannot find that either, just Adam. Where can I find that? Well, you find it in the original languages, the Hebrew language. That's the reason that the first six chapters of Genesis is the only teaching that we really recommend that you order it with visual, in other words, on DVD or on VHS tape, because we take you to the Hebrew and show you that the man created in Genesis chapter 1 is different than the man created in Genesis chapter 2. But you have to have the ability to go back to the original languages or allow someone to teach that to you. What you're missing. Penny in Pennsylvania, I thank God for you and your staff. Thank you for that. I learned so much from watching Shepherd's Chapel. My question is Isaiah 30:25. And there shall be upon every high mountain and upon every high hill rivers and streams of waters in the day of the great slaughter when the towers fall. Does this pertain to the Twin Towers in New York? No, I believe the rivers are symbolic of truth, and the towers that fall are like the tower that we read about in Genesis chapter 11, the Tower of Babylon, which means confusion. I'm out of time. I want you to know that I love you a great deal because you enjoy studying God's Word in depth. You know what? It makes his day when he looks down and he sees you studying, reading the letter that he wrote to you, the Bible. We are brought to you by your tithes and offerings. If we've helped you, help us keep coming to you and to reach out to others of our brothers and sisters who are lost in this world of darkness. One thing most important, though, and it's this, you stay in his word every day. Every day in your Father's word is a good day, even with trouble. You know why? Jesus is the living word.
Hearing God's word with understanding will change your life. We hope you have enjoyed studying God's Word here on the Shepherd's Chapel Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Dennis Murray. If you would like to receive more information concerning Shepherd's Chapel, you may request our free introductory offer. Our introductory offer contains the Mark of the Beast CD, our monthly newsletter with a written Bible study, a CD catalog, and a list of written reference works available through Shepherd's Chapel. To request our free introductory offer by telephone, call 800-643-4645, 24 hours a day. You may also request our introductory offer by writing to Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. Once again, that's Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. We invite you to join us for the next in-depth Bible study each weekday at the same time. Thank you for watching today's program, and God bless you.
The Book of Ezekiel. What a fantastic study, this book of Ezekiel. The book of Ezekiel that covers, if you would, those vehicles, those circular discs. In the Hebrew, it states very clearly that that whirlwind with the color amber traced back to the Hebrew, highly polished bronze. What an exciting thing that God's word informs us on all things. Ezekiel, one of my favorite prophets of the Bible, probably more written, not probably, but absolutely more written on what will happen in the millennium age than even the book of Revelation. Ezekiel guiding you through it, what God will expect at the final battle, Armageddon and Haman Gog, recorded in this great prophecy. I know you're going to enjoy it, the book of Ezekiel.
Welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel Network Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Arnold Murray. Wisdom is understanding God's Word. Pastor Murray's unique teaching approach brings God's Word alive with meaning as he takes you on a chapter-by-chapter, verse-by-verse study of God's letter to you, the Bible. And now here is Pastor Arnold Murray.
Good day to you. God bless you. Say welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this family Bible study hour. We're ready to get back into our Father's Word. Rapture theory. Is it just a theory? We know from God's Word we're going to gather back to Christ. In our first lecture on this subject, we learned there are two bodies. We have the flesh body. We have